Can you talk a little bit, David, about your self-blinding microdose study? Because I think that's like it's a pretty clever way of, as you say, taking advantage of the fact that this is happening, but moving beyond, and it's going to involve self-reporting, but you're also kind of creating a way that people who are doing this and are interested in furthering the research agenda can create more robust data through a blinded, placebo-controlled fashion. So tell us a little bit about that study.
Maybe before I mention that study, I just want to say that we have done two survey studies, and I think one was actually the first one was published today by Laura Kartner.
Today.
I think she just
Oh.
wrote an email that it was the being had been accepted, so the it's gonna come out from our team,
Congratulations.
and that's not that is not a blinded study. That's a survey like the other. So you can obviously collect data retrospectively, where you just collect information about what people got out of microdosing by a lot of questionnaires. Then you can have prospective, where you follow people from before, during, and after the microdosing period, which is of course stronger. And this first study that we did was one of those, so a survey study, and it showed increases in well-being. And a lot of other interesting parameters, giving optimism about microdosing working, same as Vince and other people out there studies. On the side of that study, we also developed this self-blinding method. It was developed by a collaborator who now works for our team, Balaji Gitti, and it's a very smart idea where he created this sort of manual so we could do sort of citizen-based science where people out in the world who were planning to microdose, they consented online to almost play this game where they would allow themselves to potentially be under placebo condition. So people needed to acquire different things, some small bags, print out some labels, some QR codes, some envelopes they need to get, and then not least some capsules that was not transparent, and then they put their microdoses into capsules, and then they put them into small bags with labels, they put them into envelopes and mix them in a certain way, and then a third of the participants, based on the way the manual was made, the algorithm behind it, then people, a third would end up having taking the planned microdoses that they were planning from the beginning, before signing up to the study, for 4 weeks, and then another third would end up with 1 week microdosing, 1 week placebo, 1 week microdosing, 1 week placebo, and the last group placebo all 4 weeks, and then we collected a lot of baseline data. Remember, it was sort of semi pseudonymized study online, so we the only thing we kind of needed was for contact with the people with the email address. We didn't need any personal information, as you don't do in service, but then online they were able to fill out tons of questionnaires solving tasks during the course of the study, and then in the end of each of the 4 weeks they could scan in their QR code from the envelope that they had been using that week, and then we could see whether it was an envelope with microdoses or placebos. So therefore, we knew what they were taking, but they didn't, unless they sort of opened the other envelopes. You produced eight envelopes, and you only need four. So there'll be four envelopes that you put aside. So you could kind of break the blind pretty easily. You got to also open the capsules, obviously. So with all its weakness, which is that we can't control what drugs they're using, we can't control the dose. So if people got it completely wrong or had an LSD blotter lying in the window in sunshine for 10 years, then which probably would remove a lot of the LSD, then obviously that could be problematic. So in these kind of studies, it's massively it's an advantage to be able to measure dose, and hopefully we will in our next trial, but we couldn't in this one. And also we obviously can't check whether people are cheating, but we have no impression that people do. On the contrary, we had people Because when they had finished the trial, they could be informed whether they were taking microdosing or whether it was placebo. And some of the people who were curious and got the answers and some of the results, they didn't believe it until we then wrote back to them, go in maybe and open the other envelopes, and you can see your real microdoses you haven't used yet. You basically had placebo, because we had people explaining that it was the most profound thing, and it had markedly better results than any treatments before for depression. This wasn't a depression study. It was again opportunistic sample, so it was people who were healthy, but it was also people who were trying to self-medicate, and we acquired all the information about for what reason, and we also had baseline and follow-up measures of depressive symptoms and so on. Even though if a lot of them score almost zero, it's not very informative, but there will be people who score above a certain threshold on a depression scale, and
Sure. But so it sounds like some people definitely had a placebo response. But on the whole, is there any, have you done early analysis, any data you can tell us about?
We have basically completed the paper, and that paper, now I said the other study comes before, but this one has also just been approved for publication, so it will come very very soon in the journal eLife. We have the full on data analyzed, and it basically shows that if you ignore the placebo group and just look at the microdosing, which would be the same as a prospective survey, it basically confirms all the previous surveys. It looks amazing no matter what you look at. Almost it you know improves it helps you with anxiety, depression symptoms. It increases well-being, which is the main outcome. Typically, main out well-being is the main outcome when it's not a clinical population per se. So it basically leads to multiple benefits. However, when we then take into account the placebo, which we had in this study, then it doesn't separate from placebo.
Oh
And
no.
it was actually quite
What
a
was your sample size?
yeah. That was what I was going to say. It's not a small sample size. It's 200 people. There were 240 doing the baseline, and then just under 200 completing the 4-week measures. Then their follow up after 1 month. So it was 4-week regime with whatever number people wanted to of doses they wanted to use. Most followed the example that I think we took from Fadiman. So actually, most people did it very similarly, maybe different days during the week. But there were rules: they could had to microdose on a Thursday, and they could never microdose on a Sunday. So that we could collect acute measures on a day where we knew they had taken it that morning, and then on Sundays we could sort of think about it as a subacute measure of the previous week. And then in the end, we had the accumulative data collection after the 4 weeks, and then a follow-up after 4 weeks, and then a few more people had dropped out by that time point. So in a way, I think it's the largest placebo-controlled psychedelic study in this new era of psychedelics, because no full doses are up in near that number yet. So in that regard, it is obviously very disappointing for people who have been optimistic about microdosing that this simply doesn't look very promising. Then you can say, oh yeah, but it might work in the clinical population, and absolutely. And this is with the different Achilles heels that this study has. Real big trials should be conducted, because it would be fantastic if it could work for
One thing
clinical.
that's an interesting point of context there is that if we think about, other treatments that are available for depression, especially, lower levels of depression, they also in their own trials have major issues of separating placebo effect and are not necessarily, black and white sort of response. They're showing slight improvement versus placebo in most of the best research. And so that's an important point to remember is that, the data that we're seeing is actually quite comparable to that sort of data. And, like David's saying is that, larger sample sizes may address those issues as well.